Morsenal Studio B in Chandler, Arizona, this is MayaCast. Welcome to another edition of MayaCast. I'm your host, Tom Shadle.
My host, Kip Parcell.
And this is episode 277 for Friday, May 29th, 2020. They're coming out of the walls! Coming up on today's show, we will be going through the combined army list for Code 1 on the online army free web builder. So if you're just getting started with Code 1, you're interested in the combined army, this is the place to start. Before we get into it, though, Kip, tell everybody about our quarterly painting contest.
If you have not been listening to the other awesome episodes of Code 1 we've been doing, then you will not know that this quarter we are doing Show Us Your Big Guns, which goes well with the name of this episode. All the shooty. Yeah, we're looking for your models that have SWC or a big gun. So your HMGs, your Mark 12s, your Spitfires, HRMCs, and there is no silhouette limitation. Our only requirement is it has SWC and a big gun, with the exception of the Mark 12. but yeah, since it's only one model, no silhouette, you're allowed up to four finished pictures. And we do like to stress that if you send more than four, we're only going to use your first four. So make sure those are your best pictures. but as always, we need a before picture because we want them new. So please do not share any of the pictures until they go up in our gallery. That way it can be new and like the new hotness for our contest. And if you do put them up beforehand, then you will unfortunately be disqualified, and that's something we never want to do. So get to painting some big old guns, and when you get those done, send your before picture and up to four, please no more than four pictures, all renamed with your name, T-Shadle1, T-Shadle2, and you can send those all to
Tom at MayaCast.com
and Kip at MayaCast.com. So yeah, show us your big guns.
The overall winner will win the personalized MayaCast Master Glass with your name on it. But all of the other prizes we give away, and the more entries we get, the more prizes we give out, all of the other prizes are generated randomly through random.org. So you can't win if you don't play, and everybody's eligible to win. So push yourself, paint up some giant weapons for us, and enter in the contest, because everybody can win prizes, but only one can win the coveted Master Glass. So yeah, that'll be, you got about a month left. Those will be due at the end of June. That's when the quarter ends. So get those in by the end of June, or, you know, by Independence Day, by the 4th of July. That would be, that'd be good. So let's get right into the the combined army list for Code 1.
The enemy of my enemy is my friend.
If you know the enemy and know yourself, you need not fear the result of 100 battles.
Then, heavy resistance, sir.
Yes. But why are they using such primitive weapons?
Now entering the war room.
So, the combined army list found in the Code 1 Army Builder is mostly made up of Shasvastii units. So, if you're new to Infinity, the combined army, as the name implies, is combined out of several different races that the EI, or Involved Intelligence, has taken over, subjugated, and makes use of in its conquest of the universe, trying to achieve transcendence to a higher level of consciousness. And so when the fullness of the army list is revealed to you, whether that comes throughout additions to Code 1 or when you graduate to the last remaining months of N3 or when N4 comes out later in the early fall, then you will see that beyond the Shasvastii, which most of these guys are, there are also Morats, which are the hyper-aggressive, red-skinned humanoid ape creatures that I think of a lot like Klingons. And
oh, yeah.
You know, aggressive, warlike, burly. But that doesn't mean they're stupid or lack tactics. And then there's also the aspects of the EI, that evolved intelligence can put portions of its consciousness, of its brain, into these constructs that it uses on the battlefield that are really cool. And so you'll see more of those things come in, as well as a few appearances of other smaller races, like the Toha that have been conquered by the EI, called Sigma. And you've got the Umbras. And so there's all these different races. This list focuses mostly on the sneaky Shasvastii, who are just trying to survive, man. There's a big cataclysm where their star blew up and took their planets with it, and so they're an endangered species. And that's why they all carry embryos within their body, so if they should fall, that embryo can be grown into a new Shasvastii to replace them, propagating their species and keeping it alive. So that's who we're talking about today, is mostly Shasvastii. Interestingly enough, the first thing in the army list is a character named Agent Dukash. Dukash. Agent Dukash of the Vashar Special Corps does not have the Shasvastii special rule, like almost everybody else in the list does. But he definitely has a Shasvastii logo.
Yeah, he does. That purple-yellow evil-looking thing.
Yeah, he dodges on 16s because he's got a physique of 13 and that dodge plus 3. And he moves an extra inch when he does dodge. That's important because his multi-rifle is only plus 3 out to 16 inches, so he might be doing some dodging early on in the game, so you get your plus 3 range. he is a ballistic skill 13 with that multi-rifle, and the mimetism minus 3 helps him win those face-to-face rolls by making their number worse than yours. So he's a pretty good shooter when you consider that multi-rifle is going to be damage 15 thanks to his plus 2 damage.
It's my favorite thing about him, especially being only 3 points. Being one wound and only armor 2, he seems kind of expensive for 3 points in CodeOne. But being able to be armor piercing with a damage 15, you know, multi-rifle, and then if you do have to ARO or in a position to ARO, you're able to shoot that, you know, one shot double action that's damage 15. He's a very good profile, huh? It's a very, very good.
Is that Watto from Star Wars?
I have no idea what that was. It's hot. I'm in my garage. I think I have a little bit of heat exhaustion. I've been outside all day.
That applies to his heavy pistol as well, making it a damage 16 heavy pistol. Within 8 inches. And
golly.
So, yeah, he's a specialist with a whip of 14, which is really good. And he's it's got an option to be your lieutenant. And why not? Like you said, not super survivable. Only armor 2, only one wound.
Yeah, there's a couple. There's like, if that's one of those ones that we've been talking about, that you're like, that lieutenant option's really good because it's a zero SWC model, but probably good in like a smaller point game, like 15 to like the 20, 25, because there are some other ones down the line that I would rather use as my shooting platform that are a little bit more hefty and survivable to get that extra order.
Yeah, he is. He's got the martial arts level 1 with a close combat of 21. So he's not he's not super great at close combat, but he's not terrible either. Just has a regular close combat weapon. So he does a little bit of everything, and he's kind of bargain priced at 3 points, I think, for all of the tools he has. But like many of the Shasvastii units, he is one that, while he's got a lot of cool tools and kit, once he takes a hit, he's gone. And that's sort of the that's sort of the theme of the army. They're going to make it hard for you to hit them, but if you do sneak one past the goalie, they're likely going down.
Furta.
Cadmus Naish, Agent Sheskin. Some people say Sheeskin. I say Sheskin. There's no official Infinity pronunciation guide, so good luck, y'all. She's a beast.
What about Sheskin? Yes, she is. And it's when you said, when you were talking about the lieutenant option on Dukashnish, I was immediately like, but there's Sheskin. I don't know, there's two eyes, so I'm going to say that just to throw a wrench in the gears. Yeah, she would be definitely my choice over Dukash, just because she's a beast, like you said. She brings cover with her wherever she goes.
She's also a lot more expensive than he is.
Yeah, 2 points more. It's all right. And that, or 2.5 if you take the Red Fury option.
She comes with a nano screen, which is a neat piece of equipment that always brings cover with her. She doesn't have to always stay in cover because the nano screen provides those cover bonuses to all shots against her from any angle. So her little portable ball of nanobots means like she's always going to be armor 4. She's always going to be -3 to hit because she's got that mobile cover. She's only armor 1, but like I said, it's going to be 4 all of the time because the nano screen, except in close combat. Nanoscreen doesn't work in close combat, so she'll be back down armor 1. She starts off with 2 wounds, plus she has Protheon, which means she can get up to 4 wounds. Right? Protheon's that thing where if you do a wound in close combat, you get a wound added to your profile.
Yeah.
Or heal one back if you've been damaged. And so she's got the Protheon. Martial arts level 3 and a close combat at 24, meaning she's hitting on 27s and throwing out a -3 to her enemy. Meanwhile, it's a damage 17 double action close combat weapon when she hits.
God, it's brutal. Goodness.
And she's going to crit a lot of the time because she's going to add 7 to her die roll and just has to get a 20 or higher, right? So she's going to crit a lot, which means that's damage 17 on 3 dice when she hits.
Yeah, it's almost like it's an explosive close combat weapon at that point, right?
Her dodge is amazing. Not only does she dodge on 15s because of her natural physique of 15, but she also moves 4 inches every time she dodges.
Yeah, she's quick. She's really, really quick.
As long as she's successful, right? So a 6-4 movement could be a 6 dodge and still move your 4 inches.
It's a toss-up, too. Like, both those profiles, it's like really hard to decide sometimes. For me.
Between the multi-rifle and the Red Fury options?
Yeah, because she's got the damage +2, right? So they're both damage 15. But you're like, if you're going to be running her, the Red Fury is, you know, it's pretty much just a burst 4 rifle. Because it's 8 to 20, like a marksman rifle. So it's 8 to 24 inches. So that gives you more range, right? And it's 0 within 8, but you have a pistol, so you can get the +3 if you needed it. But being ballistic skill 15, I'd roll 4 dice at 15s if you get close enough, right? But then the multi-rifle, yeah, you lose 1 dice, but you have the AP option, which allows you to go after their heavy stuff. And then in ARO, you get the double action. So it's just like, man, do you want the extra range? Do you want that extra 8-inch range band? Or do you want the, you know, easier to hurt somebody?
I always want the 4 dice over the 3 dice. And because the double action on the multi-rifle is only going to come into play if your single die in ARO happens to beat all of their dice in the active turn. And
So
while it's nice, I'd rather have her protected and not sticking her neck out in ARO. Unless she's rolling around with her 4 wounds. And, you know.
Yeah, I know, right?
Massive roadblock. But,
see, that's the thing is, like, typically I like to have that option in ARO, but the Red Fury is, it's like, you're going to be. That's the longest range option she has. So it's like, that's kind of like the go to.
Better range, better burst. Damage 15 because of her +2 damage to ballistic skill attacks. I think I like the Red Fury. Although, now you might run into SWC problems where you might not have that 1 SWC to spend because you're spending it elsewhere. So the multi-rifle is not a bad option at damage 15. So
yeah, it is a little bit of a downgrade, but
And then either one of those profiles can be a lieutenant for no extra SWC tax, which is always nice.
Yeah. And I mean, for me, this is probably one of my favorite ones. Because you do want her getting close. You do want to get her in close combat. She's a beast. And you get those extra wounds. You know, she starts with two anyway. So that's awesome. You never have to worry about hugging walls or needing cover. So it allows you to really just move extremely. She's 6'4", so move really fast and just take the angles that, you know, you want. You don't have to worry about how terrain's set up, except for the total blocking. So there's a lot more freedom there.
The Jaith Cutthroats, Shasvastii Independent Assault Group. So they're 2 or 3 points, which I'm going to say seems... The 3 points seems a little expensive for an armor zero guy with a single wound. However, it's Shasvastii, so they're harder to hit. Like we've been saying, once you get hit, you're probably dead. Mimetism minus 6. So way harder to hit. They also sport MSV1. So while they're throwing out the negative mods, they're ignoring yours. A decent ballistic skill of 12. Good close combat at 23 with martial arts level 2. So they're swinging on 26s and giving you a negative 3. And that makes their double action close combat weapon a 14. Physique a 13 plus the martial arts.
Yeah.
The thing is, the first two profiles, chain rifle with plus 1 burst and the submachine gun chain rifle, really, really short range with no deployment skills. Your only protection, you don't even have a marker state to sneak by in an order. You've only got that mimetism minus 6. So, looking at the longer range options, you got a Red Fury. You're spending an SWC to take a damage 13 gun with 4 dice on ballistic skill 12. The biggest advantage is that mimetism minus 6 he's thrown out as a penalty. And then there's a specialist operative with a boarding shotgun, which has, you know, again, it's best within 0 to 8. But now he's a specialist.
Yeah, it's a lot.
Zero SWC.
No, it's a lot. And it's...
I don't know, man. What do you think?
So I kind of, again, the way I've been looking at all of Code 1 is, you know, what's your average Joe in a 10-point army? And your average everyday Joe is 3 points. But, yeah, like the decent kind of cheerleaders in a 30-point army list is kind of how I see those 2-point guys. And the chain rifle is not bad because you do see combat jump troops being kind of in a dominant role in all of the armies, especially if you're playing against Yu Qing. We already talked about how dangerous their tiger soldiers are. So being able to have a 2-point model with either the double chain rifle if you want him to go crazy, or the chain rifle submachine gun, just to kind of give you some options, isn't too bad. Plus, if they are shooting you, you have MSV1, so you can see through anybody's mimetism, which they have, like tiger soldiers have. Most of those don't have any visor, so they're trying to shoot you at that negative 6. And usually you're like, F it, I'm just going to chain rifle you and get an automatic hit if they're close enough. And then, you know, they still take that negative 6 modifier to where they could miss their shot and then get auto hit. So, I mean, those ones I kind of like. I agree with you on the other shooty ones because, I mean, everything's like terrain permitting, right? You can say that to anything, but I don't feel really comfortable taking one of these other guys and you get one bad die roll and your armor 0. So, like, I like the 2-point options more in a 30-point army. Because, like I said, they're one point less than your average Joe, which to me seems fine for what their role would be to kind of protect, you know, somebody from combat jumps or protecting your corners or your edges.
Yeah, I think the best Jaith Cutthroat profile, though, is the character that's coming up in a second here.
Yeah.
Sargash. And I look at his 3 points, and I look at the boarding shotgun specialist's 3 points. I'm like, why would you ever take that guy when you can take Sargash? Although, it had two chain rifle templates, is a massive amount of surface area.
It really is. Especially with the split burst. Yeah, you can hit a lot with it. A lot.
The med tech Obsidon Medkanoid. For, I don't know, 6 years, I said Obsidian Medkanoid.
Yeah, me too.
It's not Obsidian. It's Obsidon Medkanoid. Everybody calls this model Dr. Worm.
Because, yeah.
Well, he's a doctor, as well as an engineer, and he's somewhat worm-like in an upright, armored sort of way. So everybody calls this guy Dr. Worm, the MedTech Obsidon Medkanoid. He's an engineer. He's a doctor. He's whip 14. That's all really, really good. He's 6'4", which is really good on a specialist. However, he's armor 1 with 1 wound, with a ballistic skill of 11 and a physique of 10. So he's not great at shooting, but he's worse at dodging. And
yeah.
So take slave drones with him so that they can go risk their little wormy lives and he can stay back and safe until you absolutely need him at the very end.
Yeah, he's almost an auto include, especially at 2 points. Because again, going off of a 30 point list, he's a little bit less than your average Joe, but he's one of those models that gives you an extra point to upgrade to your 4 and 5 point models. And at 2 points, he's a bargain. He himself moves 6'4". His little slave drones move 6'4", but he's both a doctor and an engineer. So it's pretty much like you're getting 2-for-1 pricing over here with this whip 14. The only sad thing is knives don't exist in Code 1 because Tom can tell you that he's had some pretty cool stories by winning close combat with a knife in the olden days, which is really funny. But yeah, he's by far one of the best specialists for the price out of all the armies, like all of them. He gets to do all of the things.
Yep, he's real good. You should take him. And then we come to Sargash, Tunnel Crumbler of the Jaith Cutthroats. And so he's just like a Jaith Cutthroat that we were just talking about, but he gets a close combat bump up to 24.
Mm-hmm.
And he's a specialist operative, but instead of just a boarding shotgun, he has a multi-rifle and a light flamethrower. So he gets the template weapon.
Yep.
But he gets a longer range gun with more... with different ammo options. So this is a Jaith where I think the 3 points is kind of worth it. Armor 1, 1 wound. BTS of 6, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, whip 13 specialist with the mimetism minus 6. Close combat 24, martial arts level 2, double action close combat weapon is, you know. But yeah. I'd rather have this. If I'm going to take a Jaith, I think I'm going to take Sargash.
Yeah, and it is. I know that armor 1 isn't that much different than armor 0, but it really kind of is. And I do like that. I do like that he does. And the light flamethrower. I don't really see myself wanting to pop 3 points on a Jaith Red Fury. Which I mean, yes, you are -6, -9 in cover. Depending on what their range bands are, you can kind of outrange combi rifles. But I mean, I don't know. I kind of like Sargon because you're going to be wanting him to get close anyway. And I think armor 1's a little bit more attractive than the armor 0 boarding shotgun for the same points. I mean, the only one that kind of goes hand in hand for me, just because you can outrange some people, with, you know, combi rifles and multi rifles to try to get the drop on them. But I don't know. It's just really hard. It's hard to spend that many points on an armor 0 model.
As a specialist, he's going to be fighting a lot of guys with camo mods, and that MSV1's really going to help out while he's throwing out the -6. So he'd be my choice if I were to take a Jaith. Okay, Shasvastii Nox Troops. These are your basic line infantry, your armor 1, 1 wound, BS 11 guys with all your basic options like HMG, multi-sniper, hacker, paramedic, like the Fusiliers of Pano or the Zhanshi of Yuching, it brings your very cheap zero SWC lieutenant option for 1 point, although it's whip 13. So again, in a 30-point game, like we said with all the other standard infantry, you're going to want to spend more points than one on your troopers. But they're real good at like 15 points where you want to get to your 10 orders. The one thing that does stand out to me, though, is the heavy machine gun, the HMG, because there are not very many in the combined army list. It's only the Nox troops with their ballistic skill of 11, which is not great. The Guaylos, which is much more expensive and much better at shooting the HMG. And then the Q drone, which is your total reaction bot that we'll talk about.
But
those are the only three options for HMGs in the entire
army. That's a
good
point. I didn't even think about that. Because I'm like, Nox or Nox. The one thing that makes them cool is the Shasvastii rule, which allows them to keep scoring in those missions that are scoring zones, even if they go into their embryo state, which is their special unconscious state. She's 2 points, though, for an HMG. It's like, I kind of would rather take, I don't know. I mean, I guess it kind of works, but I mean, I kind of would rather take the TR bot because I think they're comparable in points, if I am not mistaken. It's half a point more, but it's worth it. They have the same ballistic skill, but then you get to have an ARO piece as well. So I think that, like, if you wanted two HMGs, all right, that's cool. But if I was going to have to choose an HMG that wasn't a Guaylo, I'd probably pick the Q drone over the Nox, unless I didn't have the half a point. And even if I did have to drop a slave worm for that half point, I probably would take it just because it's just far better in for the entire game. Because the Nox is going to be really good on your active turn. But when we get to the Q drone, you know, like being able to have that TR is way, way better. It's worth half a point. Totally worth half a point.
Just a little shorter and fatter. But you are faster.
Mm-hmm.
They're fine, especially at lower point games. 15 points. Bunch of Nox running around. But with the limit on 10 models, there's just at 30 points.
Yeah, exactly.
Not very much likelihood you're going to take a Nox troop because you want to spend more points on better things. Shasvastii Sabotage and Destruction Unit Caliban. So the Calibans, they're kind of neat. They're camo markers. They have mimetism -3 and forward deployment 8 inches. So it's real easy to confuse them with your infiltrating camo markers, the Shrouded, because they're up far enough that they could be infiltrators. They could be forward deployment.
Mm-hmm.
Close combat of 23 with martial arts 3, so they're swinging on 26s. And then they have Protheon. They just have a regular old close combat weapon.
Yeah, martial arts level 3.
And then damage 15, though, because of the physique 13 plus martial arts, right? And then, so when I look at the Calibans, I look at the engineer because he's a specialist and he gets that deployment bump. He only has an SMG. It's a very short range. 0 to 8 is the good range for that. And he's 3 points. And then there's two Spitfires, Kip.
Yeah, this has me scratching my head.
One Spitfire is just a Caliban with a Spitfire.
Yep.
And he's 1.5 SWC and 3.5 points. While the other Caliban with a Spitfire also has multispectral visor level 1 to get rid of those -3 mods. And he costs 1.5 SWC and 3.5 points. Come on, man.
I know, that's the one. That's the one when I got to, I was like, oh, this is one profile that's like, it's completely irrelevant. Like that Spitfire without MSV1, it's like, why is it even there?
100% useless in the face of the competing one. In the full game in N3 and assuming in N4, there are things like the white noise hacking program and the albedo skill that interfere with visor usage.
Yeah.
And so if you're really, worried about somebody popping off white noise and you not being able to shoot your Spitfire through it, then, you know, but no.
No.
In the context of Code One, it is a superfluous and useless profile, and I don't know why it's there.
I wonder if...
But even beyond that...
I was gonna say, I was wondering if it's like, if it was supposed to be like 3 points. Because then it would make sense. If it was like 1.5 SWC, 3 points, if you didn't have the half a point, then you could take that. But if you spend the half a point, then you get MSV1. That would make clear sense.
Identical model, identical cost. Mm-hmm. One has MSV, one doesn't. The one without MSV is useless.
It's, yeah.
But even beyond that, as I was, you know, I was looking at those Spitfires, because, you know, you are a camo mark, you get some surprise attack, you're starting up advanced on the board a little bit, so you're going to be in good range really soon. It's cool and all, but then I think you're wasting... He's only Ballistic Skill 12.
Mm-hmm.
And you're sort of wasting Protheon. Protheon wants you to get close to things. A Spitfire mm-hmm. wants you to maintain a distance of greater than 8 inches. And so... You know, boarding shotgun, submachine gun, those are real close range weapons. You want to get up there and use them. So it's a little weird.
Mm-hmm.
It's a little like, I want to hang back with this Spitfire, but I also want to get close to you and eat your face for more vitality. So it's weird. But, you know, -3 because of your camouflage, and then you're ignoring their -3 because you're definitely taking the MSV1 version if you're taking the Spitfire at all.
No, I agree with you on the counterintuitiveness. I mean, I can't see like the Spitfire making it easier for you to get rid of some of their long range weapon models, and then allowing you to come around and get close to maybe pop around a corner and close combat somebody. But I did want to go back to that, like, 3-point engineer submachine gun. When we were talking about the Jaith and how we like Sagash better, here's your equivalent in points value that's still a specialist, has the close-range gun option, but gives you far more. Yeah, it's only mimetism -3, but you also have camo, which gives you surprise attack, which on your first shot, it's basically like having... Mimetism -6. You start 8 inches out of your deployment zone and you have Protheon and martial arts. So it's kind of like, I don't know, like that Protheon makes it a little bit more incentivized to go and close combat things. But, you know, that's kind of that weird, the way these points go makes certain profiles just really, really unattractive. But I mean, I can see the Spitfire still allowing you to get close to people. Because you can, you know, take on an HMG and then run up and outrange their combi rifles to get close to hitting some of their little hidey guys in the background.
Yeah, the 3 points you would spend on a Caliban engineer is worth much more than the 3 points you would spend on the Jaith generic specialist. Because he's not just a specialist, he's an engineer, so he can do more things.
Mm-hmm.
And... he's, you know, they both have very short range guns, only +3 out to 8 inches. The Jaith has the boarding shotgun, so he has the template option, whereas the Caliban has the engineer, but he's got all the extra, you know, he starts as a marker. And he starts 8 inches up, starting 8 inches up the field, so he doesn't have to run quite as far as the Jaith. So when you're comparing the same cost to the same cost for possibly similar roles, I would rather have that engineer than the generic specialist of the Jaith.
I agree 100%.
All right, so Noctifers. Shasvastii Tactical Dominance Special Wing. Noctifers. These are camouflage markers that have mimetism -6. And the old classic was the Noctifer missile launcher.
Yeah.
And he would sit there and wait to ARO with his missile launcher. In the fullness of Infinity, there's a hidden deployment skill where you don't even put the marker on the table and nobody knows where you are.
Mm-hmm.
And so that thing would just be hiding until your enemy stupidly came around a corner and then you'd reveal it and ruin their day with a missile launcher. And so that was the old classic. However, that Spitfire is a good little gunfighter, Kip.
Yeah, it is.
He's ballistic skill 12, just like the Caliban. Camo marker, just like the Caliban. But mimetism negative 6 instead of negative 3. He just he doesn't have the martial arts. He doesn't have the close combat skills. The Protheon, the martial arts, the stat itself, the score itself is only a 15. But yeah, Noctifer Spitfire running around, tossing out that negative 6 penalty while shooting 4 dice. Not bad. Not bad at all.
Yeah, I like that one. And it's funny, as we just talked about, you know, the Jaith with its Red Fury or the Caliban with MSV1 and a Spitfire. This is way, 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 way better than those little Jaiths because you get the negative 6, but you're also camouflaged, which gives you another negative modifier, which is insane. It's the discounted version of the Caliban, so I don't mind that as much because you do lose the MSV, but it's a whole point less. So that's really, really nice. I think the Spitfire is my absolute favorite profile. I don't mind the missile launcher. The thing with the missile launcher, though, is you're going to have far less scenarios where you're going to catch more than maybe one extra model.
There are no templates.
Oh, that's right. There's no templates. I keep forgetting about that. So that's, yeah, it's, I mean, it's job. We just did this last week too. It's like, I am an idiot. I mean, yeah, its job is to take out like those high armor people. And then after that, it's just kind of like you're giving up those dice. So, I mean, it has its purpose, but
it's risky.
Yeah, I like the Spitfire probably better.
It's risky because you only have the one die. It's offset by your probable negative 12 max modifier when you can surprise attack in bad range, their bad range, not yours, with your mimetism negative 6 and cover, right? So you can get up to negative 15 there. But the max modifier is negative 12. And then hopefully your one die, they can't even hit you back. Or maybe they're rolling for a 1. And your one die might have a chance, you know, 60% chance, plus 3 for range, minus 3 for their cover, of landing that devastating missile launcher hit. But their availability 1, and I think if I want to take one nowadays, I want to take the Spitfire as a terrifying mobile Spitfire platform. Go mow down some dudes.
Yeah, I agree. Especially being at AVA 1 and starting in your own deployment zone. Like, that is the profile.
All right, that brings us to Shasvastii Tactical Monitoring Company Mentor. The mentors, they're camo markers. They have mimetism minus 3. They have no deployment skills. And I think the most interesting thing is the lieutenant. The lieutenant can either have a marksman rifle or a boarding shotgun. Boarding shotgun's only 1.5 points. The marksman rifle is 2.5 points. They're both 0 SWC. Whip 14 is great for a lieutenant. And it's great to have your lieutenant as a camo marker. Especially when if you're playing a mission like Firefight where his identity is known, but the mission is to kill him. Just that extra layer of having the marker state where you can hide, make them come all the way into your deployment zone to find that camo marker is pretty cool. Other than that, the rest of the profiles, I mean, I guess we should mention the hacker because a Whip 14 hacker with BTS-6 is not terrible.
No. That one is actually pretty good if you're not going to take it as your lieutenant. Because, you do start in your deployment zone, but you do have camouflage, so that's helpful to move and grab things or do hacky things with it. They're not bad support, at only 2.5 points. and still getting camouflage. So even throwing one in with a boarding shotgun for an order or a marksman rifle isn't bad. But yeah, they're just kind of like that middle ground, right? Hacker can be a specialist, so that's kind of like a niche thing. The lieutenant can help you in a certain missions, so that's kind of a niche thing. I kind of just like them as like, okay, you're at 9 models, you have 2.5 points left. It's like, okay, I can throw that in there for a camo token. I don't know, it's just weird.
Even though he's whip 14 with BTS 6, I'm spending my points for specialists like the hacker on models that are going to start halfway up the field that we'll talk about towards the end, because they're at the end of the list.
Yeah, this is where we get kind of weird when they're all kind of like the same points. But yes, there's a bunch of AVA-1 models. So I think that's when you're going to get kind of pigeonholed, because like we just talked about, you know, the Calibans being cool at 2.5 points, you know, that have forward deployment and being a shotgun, so they could be a killy person. But I think that's like you're going to see a lot of these AVA-1 kind of like pigeonholing you to where they will actually have some sort of use when you need to spend those points.
I think my favorite is marksman rifle lieutenant marksman rifle over boarding shotgun, only because he's an extra point and filling up 10 slots at 30 points.
Yep.
Sometimes it gets difficult. Although tactically the boarding shotgun is super useful if you're doing that hideaway lieutenant idea for firefight, because you can probably hide in a place where they're going to be within 8 inches by the time they see you.
Yep.
So you get your plus 6.
Yeah.
Which is real useful. Then we have the 10 show experts. There's only one profile. It's a boarding shotgun. He's the FTO, so you can add him to your fire teams. not a code one thing. He has regeneration, which he's going to need because he's only armor 0 with a single wound. So he's this regenerating specialist operative, which with a nice whip 14, but with no deployment skills. And if the objectives were set up in your deployment zone, then he'd be fine. But this is not a single point I see myself spending.
I mean, regeneration makes it all right.
No long range gun, but he starts so far away from everything.
Yeah, I think it's a a low points game option. It's only AVA-1. It's not a lot. I mean, the best thing about him is, hey, if you do go down in your states phase, you can try to roll a physique roll to get back up with 10. Yeah. So it's like flipping a coin, you know? But I mean, that's not bad for 1 point.
Yeah, I don't have much use for a slot. I don't have much use for a 4-4 dude that starts in my deployment zone, whose longest range weapon is 8 inches. You know, whose plus 3 is 8 inches.
Mm-hmm. I mean, if you're just gonna throw something in because you have a point, I'd rather put him in than an ox. Because if they go down, they have a chance to get back up. Sure. Like, that's pretty much it.
Umbra Samaritan Norkias. This guy's cool. He's not very expensive. 3.5 points. And he's got 6-2 move, so he's fast. He's armor 2 with 1 wound, but he does have Protheon. And to power that Protheon, he's close combat 25 and martial arts level 4. Then he's also got close combat attack plus 1 burst. So this is very interesting, because that's very similar to having close combat level 5 or martial arts level 5.
Yeah. Right?
Because level 4 and level 5 are identical except for the plus 1 burst of level 5. By doing it this way, giving him martial arts level 4 and plus 1 burst in the profile like this, when the plus 1 burst is in parentheses like this on the profile, that never applies in ARO. Whereas the martial arts skill applies both in the active and reactive turn. So what they're saying is this guy is much better when he's on the offensive. And when it's your opponent's turn, he's not quite as good, only rolling the one die, but it's still thrown for 28. But, you know.
Yeah, I know, right? Yeah.
For ranged combat, because this is a shooting game, he's only ballistic skill 12 with a breaker combi rifle, which is good out to 16 inches. It's damage 13, but it goes off of half of the opponent's BTS. And then the double action close combat weapons, the other thing, with his massive close combat and his Protheon, he can easily get up to his three wound maximum in a single order, right?
Yeah.
He's rolling two dice. Both of those are going to be double action. He's likely to hit with both. He's scary. He should be, you got to be a little aggressive, either aggressive with him early on to get him into close combat, or you can sort of play the waiting game as long as you keep him totally hidden and safe, wait for them to get closer to you so you have to spend less orders to get to them. But powerhouse close combat, man.
Yeah, totally. I mean, he does have super jump, but it's kind of not as good as climbing plus in CodeOne. And this is a model that I actually really like. When I did my combined list, I put him in there because I was like, wow, he's somebody that would hold in reserve and try to deploy in a manner to where people are going to put a lot of their long range big guns on a certain side so that it will give you angles to run him up on turn one really fast. So I would definitely like hold him back as your model that you get to hold back and then deploy him in a manner that's going to make him a lot easier to get where he needs to be. Because every profile is a breaker compy rifle, which is cool because a lot of things have less BTS than they do armor. So he's a little deadlier when shooting like that. I think my favorite profile is the, especially if you're going to be aggressive, is the hacker lieutenant, because then he gets an extra order. And the hacking in this game is really, really good, especially trying to slow people down.
So there's basically only two profiles. There's plain breaker combi, who's zero SWC and 3.5 points. Then there's the hacking device version, which is identical except adds a hacking device, and it's half an SWC, 3.5 points. And then both of those can also be your lieutenant. So it's basically only two profiles. Yeah. Then it's whether you want it to be your lieutenant or not. Whip 15, great lieutenant for that opening role of the game. only BTS 3, but hey, it's better than his armor. And he's in a good position to win hacking battles with the Whip 15. So, and it makes him a specialist. So he can also do objectives. Yeah. He can sort of do everything. Great profile. Dig it. Like it a lot.
Yeah, the hacker's definitely my favorite. And then, again, like I said, if you're going to be aggressive, take the lieutenant.
Get that extra order.
Especially because, and if you're going into close combat, it's really cool to be able to come around a corner. With 6-2 move, you can assault people a lot easier. But if you're having to move and then just wait for your next order anyway, if it's a hackable model, now you can move, not get shot, try to immobilize them, or what the new immobilized states are. Then you can just run around and not get hit at all. You just get a free shot at your 28 martial arts. You know what I mean?
Yeah. He dodges on
15.
Dodges on 15s, and he dodges 4 inches when he does. So he's actually faster in the active turn by move dodging than he is move moving.
Yeah, for real, right? Move combat roll.
Yep.
Oh, man.
Oh, my gosh. Like totally Galaxy Quest. Malin and Galaxy Quest rolling around the rock planet. I will say, because you dissed Super Jump again, which I'm on board with, except it does become slightly more useful when your first movement value is a 6.
Yeah, it does a little bit. The other thing I was just going to say why I like the hacker over the non-hacker is there is a lot of times if you're trying to set yourself up, like I was saying, you have to move and then just burn the second part of your order because you don't want to come around the corner and get shot. But spotlight's now a thing that targets everybody. And you can, like, if you move, you're like, well, I might as well spotlight because I can.
Yep.
And that way when you pop out, they're targeted if you can get that off. So, I mean, he's just way more useful. Like, the hacker is 100%, like, worth the half SWC.
Yeah, and totally worth it as your lieutenant, with the possible exception of firefight where they're gunning for you, lieutenant. But to have that extra order in all the other missions where there's literally no penalty for losing him except that you lose your lieutenant order.
Yep.
Super good. So Nurkios is money. And I would just use any Umbra Samaritan model that you can get your hands on. Meanwhile, crossing my fingers that they actually come out with the character, Nurkios.
I know, right?
if I'm not mistaken, Nurkios is the Umbra that killed Tony Macayana.
I think you're right.
The tagline season of ITS. Tony Macchiano was a Pano character tag pilot. And I say was because her brain leaked out her nose real good.
Well said. Oh, man.
Victor Messer, autonomous agent of chaos. This guy has a nano screen, like we talked about earlier with Sheskin. Mm-hmm. And which is good because he's armor zero with only a single wound. So it's good that he brings his own cover around with him. Whip 14 hacker at BTS 3. Armed with a multi-rifle for 2.5 points or a boarding shotgun for 2 points. And then both of those profiles have burst 2 nanopulsers.
Yeah, it's really good.
He's not expensive. But he's also the type of model that, because he starts back in your deployment zone and all the specialist things are out there and a multi-rifle is not exactly long range, he's kind of one of those models that he's in your list and then you never spend any orders on him because you're spending all your orders on Nurkios or your Guaylos, right?
Mm-hmm.
And because there's not really anything that makes him super special.
No, and it's that weird two-point range too, right? So he's hard for me, man. I actually just jump over him a lot. I mean, it's nice to have a hacker that's always in cover. If you have to, you know, run across a gap, but
like to get to an objective.
He's good. I mean, that's what he's good for. Like, he's got a nano screen. He's a Whip 14 hacker. The plus one burst on a nano screen's pretty good because then you get a force your opponent. What are you going to do? Are you going to... I move around the corner. Are you going to shoot or dodge? You know? If they dodge, then you shoot. If they shoot, you can either shoot back to try to make it a face-to-face roll or burst two nano pulse them and hope you survive, you know? Yeah. But at least you get two free hits. So it gives you that little trickery. And in that sense, I kind of like the boarding shotgun because then you can really mess with them. if you're going to shoot me, I'll shoot back at my plus six range, you know, with burst two. Or I'm going to hit you with two templates at burst two. So you kind of force them to do whatever you want. At that point, they would probably just dodge, you know. And then you get to shoot them anyway because they're like, wait, you're going to be plus six? Oh, that's crappy. And if you hit me with my nanopulsers, I can dodge both with no penalty. So you might force people to dodge a lot more with the boarding shotgun profile and then just shoot.
Kodali is a little more exciting than Victor Messer. She has MSV2 and she's got martial arts level 1 and a close combat of 19. None of that's... it's not over the top at all. It's better than being a Nox trooper if you get stuck in close combat, is about what that amounts to. But there's two profiles. She's ballistic skill 14, and she's got that MSV2. One profile is a combi rifle, and that profile has combat jump, but does not have parachutist. And then the other profile is a multi-rifle. And that has forward deployment level 2. Forward deployment 8 inches. and mimetism -3. And that, by far, is my preferred profile. They're the exact same cost at 3.5 points, no SWC. Because it gives you that negative mod when people shoot at her, which the other one doesn't have. And you don't have to roll when you deploy 8 inches forward, right? Which gets you much closer to your multi-rifle's good range. Whereas combat jump, you always must roll. And at a physique of 13, that's a 35% chance of you failing and ending up back in your deployment zone with no mimetism and just a crappy combi rifle. So I much prefer in Code 1 the forward deployment 8-inch mimetism -3 multi-rifle profile with a +1 burst heavy pistol. So if you get super close, those damage 14, burst 3 on the heavy pistol, +3 8 inches, nice.
Yeah, no, the four deployments the way to go, honestly. I actually faced that model and she smoked my Dalfe in two orders. It's just really hard to go up. Yep, it's really hard when they take away all of your mimetism. So she will never face mimetism herself because it's a level 2. And then she imposes that 3 on you. And you're going to get in range of those weapons at with that 4 deployment level 2. Or level 8 inches. God, I did it too. but yeah, that is the way to go. And she is just nasty. And again, this is kind of what you think. Like, when you're building this out, it's really funny, I've noticed, is you have all these really cool pieces. So keep in mind, like, you might not use them all. Like when I played Donnie, he did everything with Kodaly and Shetskin did nothing till the last turn. He's like, oh my gosh, I have Shetskin here. It's like, yeah, that's what happens when you have all the cool things. You forget that you have cooler things that you can be using. He's like, oh my gosh, I could, like, when have you ever played a game and forgot you had Shetskin? Oh, when you have everything else cool as well. But I had a lot of camo, so Kodaly was doing all the work. It's just really funny. It's a completely different kind of experience.
Speaking of really cool things that you probably have in your army is the Shasvastii Armed Imposition Detachment, Guaylos. Alas, they are but AVA-1. This is the only heavy infantry in the combined army list for Code 1. And he's pretty baller. He's ballistic skill 13, has a nano screen, so he's always in cover. Mm-hmm. So you are free to roam, brother. Armor of 3 with 2 wounds, that all-important second wound, which is amazing. 4 points, I feel like, is a bargain. 1.5 SWC, ouch. But with that, you're either going to get an HMG or an AP Spitfire. The HMG can also be your lieutenant. So the AP Spitfire is, so it's burst 4 like an HMG. They have slightly different range bands where the HMG is good from 16 to 32, but the AP Spitfire is good from 8 to 24, which is really nice. And because it's AP, right, anything that's armor 3 or higher, it matters against. But most things are not. Most things are armor 1 and 2. And so it's basically having a short-ranged HMG when you're talking about armor 3 or more. Anyway.
Yeah.
that the 8 to 24 range band is nice later on in the game, whereas the HMG is nice at in the first half of the game. So it's really up to you preference. Looking at the lieutenant option, it's only a whip 13 for that role to see who gets to kill go first. And so I'd much rather take Nurkius and get the 15 for that lieutenant role.
Mm-hmm.
And then just make this guy the regular old HMG. But I mean, both are good. AP Spitfire, HMG, can't go wrong.
No, and the other thing with that lieutenant is, like, do you think you're going to use him more than somebody else? Then you could take him to get that extra order. I don't know. I like Nurkius, though, a lot. And Shiskin, if you're going to go on and be a murder rampager. But I kind of am digging the AP Spitfire over the HMG because you're going to be wanting to get close. So that's kind of where I was leading to, because they're the same burst, like you said. And then as soon as you hit the three and above, that's when it's going to matter and you can get closer to them.
But
and if you're shoot, I mean, if you're shooting little onesies, armor onesies, the HMG is better.
Yeah, it's and it's also better because there are not many opportunities to get an HMG, right? You've got your Nox troops, okay, who are Ballistic Skill 11, which is kind of crap. You've got your Availability 1 Q drone and your Availability 1 Guaylos. So if you want that extra range, that 24 to 32 extra range, there's not many opportunities to get it, and that's why I'd probably lean on the Guaylos to carry the HMG and then go back to something like the Noctifer to be my Spitfire platform for the closer work.
I'm just, because it's new, we actually have an AP Spitfire, so I'm like, ooh, I want to try that.
That's what the Toha tag had. What the heck is that thing called?
Gorgos,
that's it. But yeah, it had an AP Spitfire, right?
Maybe it's Toha, so sorry, Cody. I'm down with it. Down to the Toha.
I don't think you have to apologize to Cody. I think I do because I couldn't remember Gorgos. Then that brings us to... So, yes, Guaylos, HMG, or AP Spitfire.
HMG.
Take one. It's 4 points. You have to get to 30. Take it. Worth it. You want it. It's money. Then we get to the drones, which usually I would say we've talked about these in the past 2 weeks with the other armies because they're all identical. However, Combined Army is special, and they're not quite identical. With the M drone, which is the 6-4 specialist with a combi rifle, we talked about it being cool because it's a, you know, move 6-4, so it's really good for getting to objectives really fast. There's also a second option in the Combined Army, though, where it has a nano screen. So it's a half a point half a point more to get a nano screen. And if you're thinking about moving fast towards the objectives at the very end of the game to score points, you know, at the bottom of three right before the game ends, if you don't have to worry about moving from cover to cover, you become much faster with a nano screen that takes cover with you.
Oh, yeah, that is the option. Like, the only reason that you take the other one is you're like, oh, I can't afford it. I can't spare half a point. The only way you will take the non-nano screen is if you're forced to do so by points. That's just how it is.
And you have those brain power sessions in the restroom where you're like, oh, I'd have to drop a slave drone to get the nano screen. Which is worth more, keeping Dr. Worm safe? Or Yeah.
Oh, that's funny.
Next is the Q drone, which is their total reaction HMG remote that has a 360 visor. Everybody's got one. They're Ballistic Skill 11, right? But again, the Combined Army is special, so their Q drone also has mimetism -3, right?
Yeah.
So everybody else what we call TR bot, because total reaction remote, TR bot. Everybody else's TR bot is 1 SWC and 2 points. The Combined Army's is 1 SWC and 2.5 points, but it's got freaking mimetism.
Yeah, no, that's totally worth it. That's like when we were talking about earlier with the Nox. It's like, man, I would rather, again, try to fit, like, shave off half a point somewhere to take a Q drone instead of a Nox, because I have a point to get 360 visor, total reaction, and mimetism as compared to, like, the Nox that has none of those but the same ballistic skill. And that is bargain price cheap. That is like yard sale cheap. That is not even bargain price.
Only availability one, but you want to fill that availability and take one, I think.
100%.
Such a good little attack piece. And even though it's total, just because it's total reaction doesn't mean that you can't use it in your active turn. It still gets the burst 4 in the active turn. So you can use it as a gunfighter. And even though it's ballistic skill 11, the mimetism helps make up for that by throwing that -3 penalty out. Just don't go attacking your enemy's MSV pieces.
Yeah, for sure.
Now we can speed along because the R drone that does nothing except takes up a slot for half a point, which might be useful for you at the 15 point level. So he's a 6-6 mover, -3. And then the slave drones are the peripherals that help Dr. Worm out. And the same as everybody else's peripherals. And he can take up to 2. And then the T drone, which is that ballistic skill 12 missile launch. It's funny. I wish they could get the targeting equipment from the missile remotes onto the total reaction remotes.
I know, right?
But it's a 1.5 SWC, 1.5 points for a missile launcher. And worth noting, the Nox troops do not have a missile launcher option. So whereas in other armies, you may rather take your line infantry if you want to take the cheapest missile launcher possible. The T-Drone is the missile launcher. There is not one in the Nox troops profile list. Then that brings us to our last two profiles, the Malignos and the Shrouded. Or, I'm sorry, the Malignos Shasvastii Deep Incursion Corps and the Shrouded Shasvastii Pioneer Corps. And these two profiles are startlingly similar.
Yeah.
And these are the guys that get the job done. We, you know, try to find positive things to say about Jaiths and Shargoths and other specialists that start in your deployment zone. And like, well, maybe it'll get... No. These are the guys that start right up, halfway across the table, can get to the objectives well hidden, quickly. They start real close to them. They're going to get your specialist work done. They're going to win the mission for you. While other things are going to do a lot of the fighting, these guys will win you the mission. So they are both camouflage markers. They are both infiltrators, so they can start up to the halfway point. The Malignos has mimetism -6, where the Shrouded has mimetism -3. They're both ballistic skill 12, close combat 14, and physique 12. They're very, very similar. The Maligno, so we're talking about specialists, so this is important, is a whip 14, where the Shrouded is only a whip 13. The Malignos has armor 1 and BTS 3, while the Shrouded has nothing. 0-0.
Yeah, 0-0.
They're both silhouette 2, they're both 1 wound, they're both availability 2, and they have the exact same 4 weapon loadouts. Right? So your difference is a point of willpower and mimetism -6 instead of -3, and the Malignos are therefore going to be more expensive by a full point. The 4 profiles: combi rifle and anti-personnel mines. So, okay, it's, you know, good, good burst, and you're probably in your good range pretty quick because you're starting halfway up with infiltration. Boarding shotgun anti-personnel mines. This is better. And this applies to both Shrouded and Malignos. It's better because you're starting at the midway point, and their specialists are probably starting at the midway point, so you're going to be in that +6 range much, much sooner. Meanwhile, if you're a Malignos, throwing out -6, which is awesome. The multi-sniper is cool, and it's worth playing around with, worth taking in a couple of games and see how you like it. What's neat about infiltrating snipers is the angles that they can get that you couldn't necessarily get lined up in your deployment zone. They can get angles down the sides of the tables, and always surprising when a sniper pops up way outside of somebody's deployment zone that you weren't expecting.
Yeah.
Like, oh, that guy's clearly a hacker, and he's not going to reveal himself as I move here because he's just got a combi rifle. And all of a sudden you're like, I'm going to reveal my sniper and shoot you. What? You know? So it's a cool trick to play with because they don't know what's under that camo marker till it reveals. But then the money shot for both of these profiles is the hacker profile. Comes with a combi rifle, anti-personnel mines, like the base profile. Costs a little bit more, costs half an SWC, but it's a specialist. And yeah, like I said, these are the guys that get your work done. Kip, your thoughts on Maligni and Shrouded's?
No, they are. They're like your. That's where you start every list, honestly. you're starting with at least one of each on hackers. The thing is, the shroud is just your discount. You know, it's your yard sale malignos. It's the way I feel, because it's 2.5 points for the hacker. They can do most of the same things. Like Tom said, it just has no armor, no BTS, one whip less, and it's only mimetism -6.
Three.
But I've used Shrouded for a long time. Mimetism -3, whereas the Malignos is -6. Malignos is probably going to be much better at staying alive and killing things, but that's what you pay for. The thing I like about both of them, though, is the way regeneration works. So you can go down in... the majority of the time, they're only hitting you with one shot. So you're going to go unconscious. In any of those missions that you score points in quadrants, you still count as scoring because they're Shasvastii. But then in the states phase, without spending any orders and without getting arrowed, both of them have the chance of getting back up, which is freaking huge. And that's what I'm saying. Like, I would start every army with at least one of each. If not, just two Malignos and then try to fit a shroud and then build around that.
Right. You start with the two Malignos hackers. And then when you get to the end of the list and you're like, oh, I really need a point and a half, I'll downgrade this one to a shrouded.
So pretty much.
Yeah.
Pretty much. But I mean, if you take two Malignos, it's only 8 points. You're not even to a third of your army. So even, you know, if you took two Malignos and one shrouded, now you got 20 points to work with. There's a lot of 3 and 3.5 point models in Shasvastii because their lack of HI. So, filling that out is not going to be a problem. Especially a lot of camo and mimetism is not going to be a big problem. I think that's when I did my initial list. That was my theme, is everything had mimetism -3 or -6.
Yeah.
A lot of camo just because you could. But yeah, Malignos is, I did throw the sniper in my first one because, like you said, Tom, I wanted to see how it would work being able to infiltrate up there. But honestly, if you're pushing buttons or needing to do something, of course, you're going to go with two hackers. I do like the boarding shotgun, but the last time that I took the variants, like one hacker, one shotgun, I found myself really wishing I would have took a hacker. Just because you get to use your orders more efficiently. Because if you're trying to move to attack somebody, a lot of times you can't get there. You have to like move and then burn the second part of your order, what we say, because you want to idle, because you can't. If you go out, you're going to get shot for free. Being able to move and then spotlight, that makes your combi rifle just as good, because now you're +3 range, and if you do target them, they're another +3. It's just like having the +6 to your boarding shotgun, but you get an extra burst. So I really, really like that, because it gives you that chance. If it doesn't go off, okay, who cares? I'm going to come around the corner. I'm going to surprise attack them, which is going to make them a -3, but then I'm in +3, and they have a -6. So it's just like, you know, it works either way. I kind of really, really like that. I mean, if you tried to spotlight and failed, you would lose your surprise attack. But to me, it's kind of worth it. So either way, you just have more tools. So, shotguns are cool because you get the option of +6 to hit with burst 2, or you get the auto, small teardrop template. But on somebody that has mimetism -6 and surprise attack, I'd rather have a combi rifle, because now they're like, oh, I'm -9 to hit you. You don't really need the +3. You know what I mean? And even if you drop the -6 and try to target them, you know, it just makes it's just like shifting the odds into a different pool. So I think that, like, the spotlight program makes hackers so much better now, because you can move and then still use that second party order to give yourself a further +3 to your weapon, no matter what it is. So I'm finding myself always wanting to go with the hacker options, especially for those infiltrators. Cause it's nasty, and you can do it in ARO. So now they're like, oh, crap. If I come around the corner, if I don't reset, so it forced them to burn orders. If I don't reset, they could just get this off for free. And then, because they have to burn that order anyway. I get just,
airplane.
It's really good. Yeah, I know. Sorry. I think that's a helicopter, actually.
All right. So,
yeah, I don't like wasting parts of an order. It's always the hardest part.
And you almost don't have to now if your specialists are hackers.
Yep.
So I just made a list, Kip, because those are the last two profiles, right? So I just made a list based on what we were just talking about. And so it starts with two Malignos hackers. And then,
there you go.
And then a Shrouded hacker. And then a Shrouded with combi rifle. I had the boarding shotgun in there until you mentioned, you know, do you really need plus six when you're throwing out a -9 or a -12? And you get one more die. So the Shrouded with combi rifle in mind, so you can do that, lay a mine around the corner and then pop around and make them make the choice, right? So that's four right off the bat. Dr. Worm, right? And the Caliban engineer that we talked about, he can go eat some faces, get some wounds. Nurkius as the lieutenant with the hacking device. And then finally, the guns. the Guilo HMG, Noctifer Spitfire, and a Q-Drone HMG. And I think what I really want to do is get rid of that engineer because I have tons of specialists. I don't really need another specialist. I want to get rid of that Caliban and find something that's 2 or 2.5 points so that I can add some slave drones in for Dr. Worm.
Yeah, that's actually a good choice.
But it's got all of the Sorry, go ahead.
You said you needed some for 2 points?
2 or 2.5.
You could throw in another Shrouded with boarding shotgun.
I've already maxed their availability at 2.
Oh, you did? Oh, that's right. You said you did do 2. My bad.
Yeah, so I fit in everything I was super excited to take. And now I just need, you know, a 2 or 2.5 point model that I haven't.
I mean, that's where
availability on
a mentor could work, because they have the 2.5 point. Gives you another hacker if you need one close.
Out of SWC. A drop troop.
Oh, never mind then. I was gonna say if a drop troop jumps, you can hack and spotlight them.
Marksman rifle's not bad. I could take a Jaith cutthroat just to protect whoever, like Dr. Worm, protect whoever's in the backfield. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, see, that's what I'm saying. That's where they're good. I would take the double burst chain rifle. Mm-hmm. I mean, unless you're worried about jump troops running, then you could take the submachine gun for being able to shoot back at them. But that actually might not be bad, especially if you're playing against Yu Qing. Because then you have MSV1. But that's... Hey, see, we found where they're good. When you need to shave a half a point off, you throw a Jaith in there for 2 points.
And then throwing that guy in there for 2 points would give me 2 slave drones for Dr. Worm. One that can hang around the Q-Drone. And one that can hang out around the Guilo. And protect those big guns from certain death. So, yeah, I mean, that's a list I'd be excited to play with. Got all of the things I was super excited about. And it clocks in at 10 models, the maximum. 6 SWC, the maximum. 30 points, the maximum. And it's got so, so many tools. You're going to spend your life targeted with all of these camouflage hackers out there.
Yeah. No, that's solid. That's a pretty solid starting list.
Yeah, they can really...
I think the only way... I think that is actually, like, I would put out there the way to start.
They can really throw out... The combined army, that is. They can really throw out a lot of camo markers and sort of confuse your opponent as to what's what. Like we said, the Caliban, even though they're forward deployment 8 inches, that's close to infiltration range, so they might confuse Calibans for Shrouded, right? Mm-hmm. A Malignos, like say with a sniper rifle, that's in your deployment zone, might look a whole lot like a Noctifer missile launcher, right?
That happened to me. And I didn't want to discover it because I thought it was a missile launcher, and I keep forgetting there's no templates. And it was a Maligno sniper. I was like, damn it, I would have took that battle.
And then when Malignos and Shrouded start dropping mines around the midfield, it's just awash with camo. So if you're a Pano player and you know you're playing Combined Army, I'd think long and hard about that Aquila Guard with the MSV3.
Mm-hmm.
Who just passes discovers automatically. So last thing we should talk about, Kip, is Shasvastii themselves, because most of these models in the Combined Army list are Shasvastii and have the Shasvastii rule. So we should talk about what that rule means. Basically, it means their unconscious is called Shasvastii embryo state.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of going to the unconscious state, they go to the Shasvastii embryo state, which basically acts exactly like unconscious does. There's no order generation, right? They can be doctored or paramedicked. They can be shot at and taken to the dead state. But it counts as a non-null state for victory points, and they do not count as eliminated by the enemy, which means that as long as they're just unconscious or in the Shasvastii embryo state, in missions like Domination, where you have to count up the number of points you have in each quadrant to score each round,
mm-hmm.
they still count as scoring for those zones. So they're not dead until you kill them dead.
Outright, yeah. Yeah, it makes them super annoying.
The one thing that is a little bit confusing, I think, is that it says they don't count as eliminated by the enemy, and it says they are non-null for victory points. But then in missions like Annihilation and Firefight, where it describes killing, it does mention if they are in a null state at the end of the game, they count as killed.
Yes.
So it does not protect them from that, right?
Yeah.
You could table your opponent, like he's got 10 models, but they're all Shasvastii embryo models at the end of the game. That doesn't mean he still has his 30 points left at the end of Annihilation. Because it is.
Yeah, he's done.
It is a null state, and it's actually spelled out a little bit better in the full N3 rules, where it mentions that they still apply to victory points, but not at the end of the game when stuff is being killed. So
yeah,
Annihilation, Supplies, Firefight doesn't really help you, but in the Domination mission, holy cow, Shasvastii is such a pain to play Domination against.
Yeah, you got to spend the extra orders to knock them off the board.
Mm-hmm.
Especially a lot of those ones, like they're taking the Malignos and the Shrouded that have the regeneration because they can just get back up too. So it's like, well, I took care of them this round, but there's a chance that they'll be back.
Yeah.
All Terminator on you.
Really, really good solid army with a lot of character, right? They're very glass cannony. They're very frail, but they're very hard to hit. They're very sneaky. You've got to discover them. You've got to get through their mimetism -3 or -6. But then they're going to be very low armor. But then at the same time, they're not really dead. They might come back, and they still count as scoring for that Domination mission. So they're very tricky, very cool aesthetic. Great army, and if you're just starting, definitely one to check out. Lots of fun, and I'm now super excited after doodling that list up while you were talking to play some Code One with all the Shasvastii I got out of Wildfire and Beyond Wildfire.
Mm-hmm. Agreed. I played our friend Donnie, and he played with Combined, and I'm like, you know, I played Yuching because they seem pretty cool, but I wanted to play another game where I was the Combined player for that reason, because you're looking through and you're like, oh, man. Like, if I was to choose one, it would probably be Combined with O12 being close second, because we're going to talk about them next week, but they have a lot of super cool tricks like this, too. Pano would be dead last. Yuching is fun. They still have a lot of tricks, but Combined is my number one choice.
Very, Very, very cool. Hopefully that helped you out. And like Kip said, next week we'll finish off this four-part series by going through the O12 army list for the Code 1 army builder.
This conversation can serve no purpose anymore. Goodbye.
So that's going to wrap it up for episode 277. They're coming out of the damn walls. I sounded nothing like aliens, but you get
it. It's all right.
I want to watch that tonight now. Dang, love that movie.
I know, right?
Yeah, the Shasvastii.
Game over, man. Game over.
Or combined army list for Code 1. We'll wrap up next week with O12. Don't forget to get your MayaCast Masterclass submissions in. You've got one more month to go. So it's big guns. Focus on those weapons. Show us your hugest hardware. And maybe you can win the personalized engraved MayaCast Masterclass. And if not, hey, you with everybody else are entered to win a selection of random prizes. The more entries we get, the more prizes we give away. As always, thanks to all of our patrons over at patreon.com/MayaCast. This show does not continue without your support, so we really appreciate the donations over there, which is another place we give out prizes. And in fact, at the show after the O12 show, we're going to have to give out the prizes from May. So, yeah, very, very cool. Thank you for listening, and until next time, get out there, if at all possible, in whatever way possible, get out there and support your local game stores and food banks.
Small businesses.
Yeah, thems. Thanks, everybody, and good night.
To find out how you can support the show, go to patreon.com/MayaCast.
You can find us online at www.MayaCast.com.
We are on Facebook at facebook.com/InfinityMayaCast.
Follow at MayaPodcast on Twitter.
Join the MayaCast forum group on Facebook.
And as always, you can email us at tom@mayacast.com.
And Kip@mayacast.com.